just as we are one, so that they may be one just as we are one. When I was with them, I protected them in your name that you gave me, and I guarded them, and none of them was lost except the son of destruction, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you. I speak this in the world so that they may share my joy completely. I gave them your word, and the world hated them, because they do not belong to the world any more than I belong to the world. I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world any more than I belong to the world. Consecrate them in the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, so I send them into the world. And I consecrate myself for them, so that they may also be consecrated in truth. It's the gospel of the Lord.
May know the very joy of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. and that we may know it completely. I gave them your word, that is, he gave us his very life, that very word that created the universe and all that is, that created all things that are and brought them into existence. He gave us that word. He inspired us to know, even mediated through the experience of our daily lives, to know the fullness of the wisdom of that divine word, that eternal word. I gave them your word, and the world hated that, because they do not belong to the world any more than I belong to the world. Words of Christ Jesus again. So here we are receiving those words, the blessing of God himself. And yet, the world hates us for it. And we don't even need to get into the specifics, but we can know that the politics and the legislations of our own state, but our country as a whole, speak against so much what we know to be true, as we are consecrated in the truth. That is the very right to life. That is the very nature of the human person. That is the very reality of what marital love is. We know that there is so much that the world disagrees with us about. And sometimes we feel that turmoil within ourselves. How could this be? I gave them your word, and the world hated them, because they do not belong to the world any more than I belong to the world. Any more, that is, that Christ Jesus belongs in this finality of our lives. No, he is the very Son of God. He is in the very majesty of heaven itself. And just as he does not belong to the temporality and the weakness of this life, so too do we not belong. So too may we be reminded that we are called to the very majesty and glory of heaven. And by our will and by our actions, by our very faith, we are coming to know what it is to be in the very glory of heaven. Not a glory saccharine as it could be in this life, made by our sentiments and affections, but rather in the truth in which we have been consecrated. And the world hated them because they do not belong to the world any more than I belong to the world. I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. And this is a prayer, perhaps, of the Lord that should strike us. I do not ask that you take them out of the world. Why wouldn't the Lord ask God the Father to take us directly to heaven? Why is it that he allows us to remain? Have you considered this fact? The prayer of Christ Jesus himself, not asking the Father to take us out of the world. Why? And that is a question I leave for you. Why has the Lord called you into life? Why has the Lord allowed you to remain in life when so many others are lost? So many others, perhaps, from our own families, die at too young an age. Why is it that the Lord allows us to remain in life? Because it is his prayer that we do. And perhaps we can come back to those words that he began his gospel with. Lifting up his eyes to heaven, Jesus prayed, saying, Holy Father, keep them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one just as we are one. That the Lord desires us for unity. He desires us to be in authentic and eternal communion with him. And perhaps we can pray and understand why the Lord allows us to remain in the world when we hear from the letter of St. John, speaking to that very unity. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also must love one another. If we love one another, God remains in us, and his love is brought to perfection in us. That our earthly life, our human existence, is an opportunity, is a practice for that love to be brought to perfection in us. This is why we come to Mass each and every week, to be reminded of the communion through which we are called. And this is why we practice so diligently every day of our lives to avoid sin and to foster communion. To be reconciled with our brothers and sisters, with our neighbors, with the stranger who honks at us on the street, who sits on the tail end of our car with the lights bright in our mirror. If we love love between them that is the Holy Spirit. We are called to authentic communion. And it's an interesting consideration, and one that we don't have enough time to get into today, but one that I'll just simply go over as quickly as I can. A consideration of what is communion. Because we can understand hierarchical communion, we can understand ecclesial communion, we can understand spiritual communion, we can understand sacramental communion. As we know, Holy Communion itself. And if I may just touch on that briefly, quite quickly. In our first reading today, we hear of that hierarchical communion. Peter stood up in the midst of the brothers. There is a group of about 120 persons in one place. My brothers, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke beforehand concerning Judas, who was the guide for those who arrested Jesus. He was numbered among us and was allotted a share in the ministry. Judas was one of the 12. He had a great mission to be able to participate in that very evangelization, spreading the good news of the gospel of Christ. But he wandered. He left that very ministry. He became one who led those who arrested Jesus. Therefore, it is necessary that one of the men who accompanied us the whole time the Lord Jesus came and went among us, become with us a witness to his resurrection. What is St. Peter doing in today's first reading but fulfilling that hierarchical communion? That just as one left the company of the apostles, another has come to take his place, St. Matthias, is celebrated providentially tomorrow. This feast is the feast of St. Matthias, the first of the new apostles. And not just that Matthias was fulfilling the 12, but that very succession of the apostles continues today. Who are the successors of the apostles but the bishops? The bishops of our church today, numbered across the world, are those who are continuing the very mission of proclaiming the word of God. The hierarchical communion still exists. It is the very communion of the church in her hierarchy, united with the vicar of Christ that is the head. And then we look to ecclesial communion, how much we would desire to be united with our brothers and sisters who have separated from the body of Christ, who have separated from the church. Since 1054, close to a millennium, the anniversary is coming up of the separation of the church, the Latin Rite and the Orthodox. And how much it grieves us when we recognize that there are those who are members of the body of Christ and yet we have been separated. And then even more recently, in the 16th century, when there was that protestation against the communion of the body of Christ. And how many of our own brothers and sisters, perhaps even within our own families, are now deprived of the communion with the body of Christ because they worship in other ecclesial communities. Even here on Main Street, just across the way. So there is a desire for ecclesial communion, and I thank the providence of Almighty God that just this week, of all places, I was in Scranton. I celebrated my birthday on Tuesday. And where was I? In Scranton. Who wants to be in Scranton on their birthday? Well, there I was. Why was I there? Because the bishop had asked if I would join in the dialogue between the Polish National Catholic Church and the Roman Catholic Church. They who for over 100 years, the longest-running schism within the United States, separated from communion with the Catholic Church because of the imposition of authority against it, against them. And so we're seeking to bring communion back into the life of the Church, that we may not be separated, but that we may be one, just as the Father and the Son are one in today's gospel of the earth. How providential it was that I was able to participate in that. And even this past week, a meeting with a couple of beautiful women who were hoping that we could host a community Bible study here. But knowing that when we profess faith in the Bible, we profess in the truth that we must understand properly in its context. But even still, the opportunity for us to meet and discuss and seek out how can we how can we proclaim Christ crucified and resurrected together? Again, the topics of this week. Spiritual communion, the gift of the Holy Spirit. The gift of the Holy Spirit, that we may be one as God is one. That gift that has been given to us, that we may not be orphans, that we are not alone. That just as Christ ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father, he is still there in the midst of us. The Holy Spirit joining us together, prompting us within the heart to know how to respond to the invitation of the Lord, come and follow me. In spiritual communion, that's all I'm going to say because there's too much to get into. And finally, let's close with sacramental communion. Sacramental communion where we receive the very body and blood of Christ. This is not merely a symbol. This is not merely a simple sign of what we believe, but really the very flesh and blood of Christ. Just as the head has ascended to heaven, here is the very body given to us, that we may become the very members of the body of Christ. As Christ the head is in heaven, we may be joined already here in his very body on earth. We can enter into that mystery. Spiritual communion, sacramental communion, a greater gift than just a symbol that we receive. It's not just a wafer, it is the very body of God, Christ Jesus himself, duping our very eyes. And so I ask in this final moment, what is it that we can do to foster communion? What is it that we can do in our families and in our homes to be able to draw others into that faith? To draw others into that communion of the Father and the Son with the Holy Spirit. What is it that we can do when perhaps we're struggling to get to Mass? Maybe we're griping at our mom and dad for bringing us here. Maybe we're frustrated with the brother and sister for the way that they acted during some difficult time in the family. What is it that we can do to foster communion within our own families? And what is it that we can do to foster communion within ourselves? Do we know what we receive when we come to receive the Blessed Sacrament? Do we know that if we've committed some sort of sin, we have separated ourselves from God because we have chosen our will against the will of God? Have we missed the holy day of obligation this week because of negligence or indifference? And will we pretend to come forward and say that we are in communion if we haven't even been reconciled with the Father in the sacrament of confession? There is much that we can do to foster communion. Let us begin with ourselves. Let us begin with our families. Let us begin here within our church to love one another as God has called us to love. This is our prayer. This is our faith. This is the communion of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.